First World Order Radio. Finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace, you back once again with First World Order Radio. And your host is Dr. Ali Mel Bay. And we're going to my co-host right now. Brother L, are you here?
I tell you, Washita East.
Yeah, I tell you, Washita East. Doc, how you doing tonight?
Doing well, very well. Boy, how you doing?
I'm doing well, Doc, doing well.
All right.
All right, we're going to get into the topic of discussion for tonight, in which that is dealing with Washita in the sense of the oldest indigenous people on earth. Anything you want to build on about that, brother?
Say what now?
I said we're going to be dealing on the Washita, the oldest indigenous people on earth.
All right. All right. I got you.
That's
yes,
the
sir.
Topic. If you had anything that you want to go into, I'm about that information now.
Yeah, sure. I was talking to a brother today, and he was talking about, these two Chinese women I talked to recently.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to ask, sometimes I asked them, I said, what do you put down on your applications or documents, things like that, when they say it's race, religion, nationality? Do you put down yellow? And she says, no, we don't do that. People are not colors. So I said, okay, all right. That's what I said. You just asked what I wanted to hear, what I wanted to find out anyway. And that shows what we have been talking about all the time. A lot of us calling ourselves black, African-American. And, oh, by the way, I just found out from my Sudanese Moor that they added another country to Africa. Now they have 54 nations.
Oh, okay.
I found out, And she was telling me, she said, I asked her what language does she speak, and she said she speak something like Geese.
Right.
And I said, I thought they speak that in Ethiopia, well, Abyssinia.
Right.
And she said, yeah. She said, that, I said, yes, you just said it right. It's Abyssinia. It's not Ethiopia.
Right.
But she said, anyway, she said, we have many faces. And what she meant was, you've got 100 different languages in this country, and you've got 100 different languages in that country. In my
right.
sector, we have 66 different languages.
Mm.
And she said, I would teach her my language, but it would be, you know, it wouldn't be no use to you. You know, so, I mean, she kind of really explained herself. And we were talking about also, we were talking about what I told her, what my encounter with these two Chinese women. And she said, yeah, they are right, you know, because there's no people are not colors. You know, and I told her I was a Washita Moor of the Moor Nation. And she said, oh, okay. You know, I told her we are recognized by the United Nations. Also, our project number is 215. That's our project number. And we are the nations among nations.
Right.
Yeah, so that's you know, if that's, you know, I'll add that on to the Washington history today.
Right. All right. Well, that's excellent. That was an excellent bill, brother. And since we're since you got us on the topic of language, let's get into that information, because people always ask me, well, what is the Washita language? Well, Dr. Barry Fell, and also one of Dr. Barry Fell's colleagues, bought him a book from Harvard's library that was written by a missionary priest and published in 1866.
Mm.
It contained a document titled The Lord's Prayer in Mi'kmaq Hieroglyphics.
Hmm, Mi'kmaq, that's
bad. Right. Now, Dr. Barry Fell is a Harvard professor. Now, Fell saw that at least half of these hieroglyphics were Egyptian. So when people ask us what language do the Washita speak, we speak Metuneta. Now, he was able to prove from the writing testimonies of other priests that the Mi'kmaq was using this writing when the first missionaries arrived.
Mm.
In fact, all the northern Algonquin families of tribes to which the Mi'kmaq belonged apparently used it.
Mm.
Okay? Having acquired this language from the Labian Marinas, which was the Moors, you know, and preserved it for over 1,000 years.
Mm-hmm.
And as Dr. Barry Fell began to study the Algonquin language, he found hundreds of Egyptian words in the dialect of the Northeastern, you know what I'm saying, Algonquin. So their whole language, you know what I'm saying, that, you know, at least half or more of their language was actually Metuneta. And that's right here in the States, brother. So that proves that people when we get to President Abraham Lincoln and him calling at least five of the states in which that is southern western states, you know, midwestern states, in which that he referred to as the Egypt of the West.
Mm.
Okay? He referred to the Egypt of the West because that's the language in which that they were speaking. All right? A matter of fact, he said the verb "na" to see is the same in both languages. So is "na," which means to be weak, or "nechnat," which is child. And the name of many what they call American Indian, you know what I'm saying, actually turned out to be Celtic also. A lot of the names of the so-called New England rivers, you know what I'm saying, were actually Celtic. Now, if anyone watch What They Never Told You in History Class by my man, Hakeem H.Y. Bay, he breaks that information down in that video. So I suggest everyone get that. And he says the names of many, you know what I'm saying, other words, so she's very fell, suggested that Egypt may have been in intense contact with North America. And, of course, that is strongly possible, and matter of fact, it's factual, because the Smithsonian tried to hide it when they found 18 temples in the Grand Canyon. Right, and well, I'll get to that article in a second. But he goes on to say that, you know, that they had huge boats, which were discovered in 1950, you know, adjacent to the Khufu Great Pyramid. They were buried beneath between actually 2,589 and 2,566 B.C. So this is 2,500 years before this so-called Christ. You know, of course, we know didn't exist, but still, this is the allegory, you know, saying they saying came 2,000 years ago. But here it was, 2,500 years even before that, in which that they found ships adjacent to the Khufu temple, which is Cheops, in which that these huge boats, obviously, they speculated was used in order to cross the Atlantic Ocean. You know, and it says other boats were left intact, awaiting additional funding to rebuild them as well. It says the ships were perfectly capable of crossing the Atlantic. And also there's an excellent article about these boats and may be found in April, May 2004 issue of the Ancient Egyptian Magazine. All right, now, according to Michael D. Cole, the author of Breaking the Mayan Code, he's a Yale anthropologist and a leading expert on the Mayan language. He says that the Mayans' writing is in many ways similar to the Egyptians, using the logographs along with the phonetic indicators. Mm-hmm. All right, so also it says the Mi'kmaq language was discovered by Catholic priests in 1609 when, as they preached to the Indians, they were shocked to see them taking notes in a strange language. The priests copied the characters, which much later was compared to hieroglyphics used by ancient Egyptians and was found to have many of the same meanings. All right? So the Mi'kmaq language not only looks like Egyptian, it has many identical meanings. Okay? Now, we know this to be true because we talked about this before, that Dr. Leo Wiener, in his book, Africa and the Discovery of America, he states that when Columbus went to address the kings of the West Indies, he sent interpreters who spoke Hebrew, Arabic, and Chaldean. Now, anyone who knows who's the linguistics, who studied languages, know that Hebrew, Arabic, and Chaldean are actually remnants of Metunetu. Okay.
So the Metuneta is the language we speak in the Ouachita?
Yes, that is our language, is the Metuneta.
All right.
Because the word Ouachita, as we've broken down several times before, essentially means that symbol in which that is at the top of the caduceus, which is the sun disk and the wings in which that spreads out across it, in which that is known within Malachi, the fourth chapter, the second verse, that the son of righteousness comes with healing in his wings. Not only is that our symbol, that is our language, which is the Metuneta, as well as also the word Ouachita, as we spoke about before, is from the word Ouachita. And the word Ouachita, which is Ouachita, means the serpent goddess, or the serpent-headed one. He's talking about when the serpent on the crowns of the ancient Egyptians or the Tamarains, or what is also known as the Kemetans, they wore that serpent right there at the forehead level between the eyes, in which that symbolized the activation of the pineal gland, which is the Kundalini activating the pineal gland. So actually it symbolizes the ascended serpent, or the serpent in the rainbow, which is talking about the chakras, or the serpent on high, Enuma Elish. You know what I'm saying? So that's what it symbolizes, whether it's Egyptian or whether it's Sumerian, it all comes back to the same thing. Now, there was an article I was talking about in the Arizona Gazette, Monday, April 5th, 1909. Headlines reads, Exploration in the Grand Canyon. And it says, remarkable finds indicate ancient people migrated from Egypt, tracing back to Ramesses, to where? America.
Wow.
Right? So, let's get into that particular article because it breaks it down. It says the story and that appeared in the Arizona Gazette the evening of April the 5th, 1909, was not some sort of routine National Enquirer and sensationalism, as has been suggested by many debunkers and discussion on the internet, all right, based on tedious research, all right, and also over microfilm Gazette newspaper surrounding the story for several months has turned up nothing of the sort. In fact, the search has demonstrated clearly that the opposite is quite true. In other words, this was real. And it says that the Arizona Gazette was the evening edition of the daytime Phoenix Gazette, and both editions were the forerunners of the Arizona Republic. The two editions was a mainstream Phoenix paper, as is the Republic. It says it would be hard for a serious reader to come up with an example of sensational made-up story in the Gazette. So it goes on, and it says that the most sensational story I can find, as I was searching, was a skeptical basis bias that story might have been made up, was extremely, what it says is that it was extremely boring article of a piece of sugar beets and the prospect for a bright financial future for both the farmers and the Valley of the Sun, which is Phoenix. And it says an occasional story of a local citizen shot in the argument. These was the articles in which that was surrounding this particular article. Most of the rest of the article was politics as usual and a small announcement of Lady Sewing Circle church meetings and outings, reviews, and announcements of local touring, performing, you know, troops, you know, and so forth and so on. So I got the article. As a matter of fact, you can pull the article up yourself, and it goes on and it says, let me see here. Let's go to it. It says, one of the interesting features of the trip was passing through the way of the Laguna Dam, in which that he said that he made his passage and that some interesting archaeological discoveries were unearthed. And altogether, the trip was of such interest that he was that he would repeat it next winter in company of friends. Now, this is the individual who in which that the article was talking about, in which that, you know, he would come back in order to do more excavation, because this here was something of a fascinating, you know, discovery. It says remarkable finds in the case, ancient people migrated from the Orient. All right.
Mm-hmm.
And also there's another article called The Egyptian Ruins in the Grand Canyon, Archaeological Cover-Up, which is by David Hetcher Childress. It says, perhaps the most amazing impression of all the excavations at the Egyptian tomb by the Smithsonian itself in Arizona, a lengthy four-page story of the Arizona Gazette on April 5th, 1909, gave a highly detailed report of the discovery and the excavation of rock out by Professor S.A. Jordan of the Smithsonian. The Smithsonian, however, claimed to have absolutely no knowledge of the discovery, all right?
Okay. Now,
the idea that ancient Egyptians came to Arizona area in the ancient past so objectionable and preposterous that it must have been, that it had to be covered up. So this is the reason why they did it. And it says, perhaps the Smithsonian Institute is more interested in maintaining the status quo than rocking the boat with astonishing new discoveries that overturn previously accepted academic teachings. Historians and linguists Carl Hart, editor of The World Explorer, then obtained a hiker's map of the Grand Canyon from a bookstore in Chicago. Pouring over the map, he was amazed to find such as areas north side of the Grand Canyon to have Egyptian names. The areas around 94 Miles Creek and Trinity Creek had areas, formations, in which that was called the Tower of Set, the Tower of Ra, the Tower of Horus, the Tower of Osiris, and the Tower of Isis. In the Hornet Canyon area were such names as the Cheops Pyramid, the Buddha Cluster, the Buddha Temple, the Manu Temple, the Shiva Temple. All right? Now, you got to understand, the word Buddha was actually Ptah. So this actually was a Ptah temple, Temple Ptah. All right. So, so there was any relation between these two places and the alleged Egyptian discoveries of the Grand Canyon? And then here it goes. We We called a state archaeologist at the Grand Canyon and was told that the early explorers had just like names like Egypt and Hindu names. But that is the truth of that area was off limits to hikers and other visitors because of dangerous caves. This is what they claim. Indeed, the entire area with the Egyptian hieroglyphic place names in the Grand Canyon is forbidden zone. No one is allowed into the large area. We could only conclude that there is an area where the vaults were located. Yet today, the area is cautiously off-limits to all hikers, even in large parks and park personnel. So even the personnel can't go. The Smithsonian Board of Regents still refused to open this meeting to the news media or to the public. If Americans ever allowed inside the nation's attic, as the Smithsonian has been called, what skeletons may they find? All right. So you also find that according to Ancient American Magazine, issue 73, ancient Egyptian carvings on the Palisades of New Jersey and the hillsides of Upper Manhattan, New York City. Once again, there's ancient Egyptian carvings in New Jersey and in New York. All right. Now you know the Mi'kmaq from out of northern, the northern part of the United States, or what is now called the United States of, and some of them has gone up, you know, from out of the New York area, Connecticut area, on up into the Canadian area. Now, it says John Gallard stated that this cliff directly next to New Jersey, the end of George Washington Bridge at Fort Lee, New Jersey, showing a giant face with monograms representing the pharaoh Chinook Akhenaten Ra. All right? Dating back to 767 to 730 B.C.
So you know, brother, now, that kind of resembles some of the what the so-called Native Americans speak today.
Right. Exactly. And this was 700 years. This was 700 years before the so-called birth of Christ. All right. These carvings was made around 750 B.C. during his reign. The followers of Pharaoh Shishuk formed the later Shoshone tribes. So the Shoshones are the descendants, direct descendants of the Egyptians. And it was 12 Shoshone tribes. And guess what, bro? They was all indigenous people.
They all what now?
They was all indigenous people. They was Moors.
Wow.
So it says that this is an Egyptian hieroglyphics in which that has been verified, brother. This is right there in New York. In New Jersey. You know what I'm saying? So Egyptians were here, and many of the Algonquin tribes spoke Metunessa, brother. This is why a lot of the chiefs was called Shechem. And the word Shechem means power within ancient Kemetic language.
Hmm.
All right?
All right.
Yeah, so I wanted to get that in there because we got more to go over, but I definitely wanted to get that information in there. And I want to go back to what I was saying about if you go to A.E. Wallace Budge, the Book of the Day, the hieroglyphic transcript of the Papyrus of Ani, translated to English, an introduction by E.A. Wallace Budge, who was the keeper of the Egyptian and the Assyrian antiquity at the British Museum. This is what he said. The goddess Uisheta, right, which is the same word as Washington.
Yeah.
Serpent-headed. That's what it means, brother. It means serpent-headed. And it says was a form of Hathor, which is Hetheru, and was identified with the appearance of the sky in the north when the sun rose. She is either depicted in form of a woman having upon her head the crown of the north and the scepter, round was a serpent is twined, or as a wing, Uraeus wearing the crown of the north. Ooh, she was the principal goddess of the town of Buto in the Delta. Okay? And this is what is said by our teachers. Check this out. Let's get to it here. Let me see what best we can start at here. So we can go to African Origin of Biological Psychiatry by Dr. Richard King, which he speaks about the U.S. Shetha, all right, and how the masculine form of the U.S. Shetha, which is the feminine, is the Uranus. As we know, that later becomes the Caduceus. So this is the medical symbol, which that is on the hospitals. That actually is our symbol, brother.
Yeah.
Washita. Yeah. That's our symbol for the Washita, especially really? The top portion with the sun disc and the wings coming from it.
Now we all there.
Right. So, as a matter of fact, there's a book entitled Secret Archives of the Vatican, written by Marie L. Ambrosian. And it says there is reference to a document that was in the Vatican secret archives describing a voyage by the Queen of Sheba, which is Hatshepsut, crossing the Atlantic to America.
Huh. That's something.
That's what it says, brother.
Man.
And that's right from the Vatican. Okay? So, we know that the Egyptians crossed here, and we are the descendants, and the Olmecs were the Egyptians, because the Olmecs are the descendants of the Dogon, and the Dogon were the Egyptians 8,000 years ago. All right? So, this is what we do know. All right? Let's go down, get some more info here.
All right. Some of that steel mind blowing to me.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's so much information to get out here.
Yeah. It sure is.
Yeah, brother, man.
All right. Let me see here. I don't know why this information isn't pulling up, but we'll go back over and find it.
Okay.
All right. This is the information about the U.S. Shetha. This is coming from Muwatta Ashby. All right. Matter of fact, this is what it says. Even before I get to Muwatta Ashby, let me go to The Destruction of Black Civilization by Chandler Williams. This is what he said. The original Moors, like the original Egyptians, were black Africans. Okay, so he was already giving you a clue who the Moors actually were. They were the Egyptians. They was the priesthood of the Egyptians. All right.
So when people speak of Kemetic science and Moor science, they're one and the same.
One and the same, brother.
There is no separation of the two.
Exactly.
You know, they say that the Moors are the guardians of the Kemetic science, but the guardians, well, come on, are the Moors Kemetic. You might as well say Kemetic Moors. That's what you might as well say. Or
right,
Moors Kemetic. No, whatever. You know.
Right, or just Washita.
Right.
Which, that's what Washita is, the Kemetic Moors.
Like you say,
Ushita. Right, Ushita. Ushita.
Ushita.
Yep. And this is what it says. It says, Ushita means Wichita, or Washita, which means the mother of the mystics.
Wow.
The mother of the mystics, which is the indigenous word in which that the word Oshita has the same meaning as the Egyptian word Oshita, which is derived from. This is what it said. Now, we go further. It says, from immemorial, the serpent of the symbol of the winged sun disk, which is Ur-Washita, has been used to signify freedom, expansion of the mind and the soul. In the ancient Egyptian myth of Osar, it is said that Heru defeated Set by becoming Ur-Washita, or the winged sun disk, the all-encompassing divinity. And it says Heru defeated Set by becoming the Ur-Washita, which it says the sacred form is the winged disk with the two Uris, which are the two serpents.
Mm.
Now, you know, that's the same symbol as the Caduceus. And this is from
right.
the Osirian resurrection myth.
Same thing.
Right. This is from the Osirian resurrection myth. Dr. Muwatta Ashby goes further. He says, in the Egyptian Tantra Yoga Guide to Love, Sex, Marriage, Relationship, and Spiritual Enlightenment, he says that the Ur-Washita is the epitome of the ancient Egyptian tantric mystical philosophy, as it still is today. It is the supreme of the supreme understanding of all of the all-encompassing, all-pervading, and absolute existence. Therefore, the wings are used by both gods and goddesses, which are the Netzarus, in ancient Egypt mythology, because the supreme divinity encompasses both male and female, all opposites in all existence. Thus, in order to overcome evil, it is necessary to discuss the all-encompassing vision of creation. Within this understanding, there cannot be evil since there is no duality, which is the opposites. So, it also means that we end with that symbol. It symbolizes the supreme oneness, which is the same as Ur-Ra. So, Ur-Washita is same is the feminine of Ur-Ra, which is Allah. So obviously, Ur-Washita is actually a lot.
Hmm.
Okay, and it says, according to M. Mespero, in his book, The Memoirs, Sir Clarkeith Papyrus, and it says, the goddess Washita cometh up from the underground and would change their faces into things of beauty with brilliant eyes of light. And it says, I fly up and perch myself upon the forehead of Ra in the boat of his boat, which is in heaven. I am the spiritual body of the sustainer of my yacht, which is made by the goddess Ur-Washita. What is that, brother? That's what it said. So now we know that based on the teachings of Dr. Richard King, in his African Origin of Biological Psychiatry, he states that the Africans believe that the unlimited power of individual godhood occurred when one sees God. Now, keep that in mind, because it says, when the serpent raised to the sixth stage, the form of God is seen. But a slight veil remains. It is as if one can see the light within a lantern and thinks that the light itself can be touched, but the glass intervenes. This is from the New Encyclopedia Britannica in 1992. Now, we know that in the Old Testament, Genesis, the 32nd chapter, the 30th verse, it says, and Jacob called the name of God Peniel, which is the penile. For I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. And as he passed over Peniel, it says, the sun rose upon him, and he halted upon his thigh. All right? Now, if you go to Nutricize by Dr. Leila Africa, there's a picture on page 15 that is the actual photograph of inside the human brain. The cells of the brain are magnified to the equivalent size of a car. Over top of the pineal gland is an electrical magnetic cloud that looks like a galaxy.
Wow.
Or sideways, it looks like a UFO, brother. And this is called the Eye of Heru. It is inside of the brain in the fluid-filled chamber of the third ventricle. The Eye of Heru, which is Horus, is alive, active, and floats above the pineal gland and influences melanin and the spirit world unseen. So when the Kundalini goes to that area, that's when you see that light develop and DMT is produced from the pineal gland. And pineoline is produced from the pineal gland, in which that gives you access to tapping into ancestral acknowledgement, which is spirit communication. All right, so we go to New Testament, Luke 11:34. It says, the light of the body is the eye. Therefore, when thy eye is single, the whole body is also filled of light. All right, so this is what this is all entails when you become Washita, is understanding the spiritual depth of what you're getting into.
Mm.
Matter of fact, Dr. Barry Fell, once again, Harvard professor, shows images that looks like the all-seeing eye in ancient North America, around the whole northeastern United States of America.
Hmm. Okay. Man, that don't tell you nothing else will.
Exactly. Yeah, go ahead, brother.
I mean, what else do they need? I mean, man.
I don't know.
Oh, man, doesn't he just drop a boulder rock on top of him or what?
Well, Prophet Riley, when it fall, what you want me to do, kill you?
Right, man. Wow.
And then you wouldn't know for real, then, wouldn't you?
No, they wouldn't.
You know.
Oh, man, I just keep on just putting it on them, you know, I guess.
Yeah.
They'll get it. If they don't get it, well.
Yeah. Right here in the coffin text, says the coffin text of the New Testament, the Eye of Heru is called the Eye of the Soul. It says, such as Heru or Horus, which has been reappeared, resurrected in glory, for he has fashioned his bodily eye. Behold, it is stronger than any of the gods. Is the soul eye stronger than the gods and Set? You know what I'm saying? So it goes on further in the pyramid text of the Old Kingdom, the Eye of Heru, forehead location, and the relationship to sunlight. It says, the utterance 5:23, it says, make the sky, makes the sunlight strong for you. Check this out now. May the sky make the sunlight strong for you. May you raise up to the sky as the eye of Ra. May you stand at the left eye of Hun, which is Tahuti, where speech of the gods, the Netarus, us heard. Stand up at the head of the spirits of Hun, Tahuti, stood at the head of the living. Okay? In the Egyptian text, it goes on and states, I have approached with worship the two Kati gods and Sekhmet, who are in the temple of the Age One, which means in Anu or Ra. And the two Katis, or the Katihu, are in the Hindu Vedic text as the Ida and the Pingala. And Sekhmet is actually the Shushuna, which is the hollow area in the spine in which that the Kundalini travels up through. So see, when we start putting this information together, then we start seeing the symbolism from all of these particular texts and how it's doing nothing but talking about you and your enlightenment.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now, it is the Ueshet, which is the serpent deity, which was worshipped in the ancient Egypt as the sign of sovereignty and royalty. Hold on. Let's go back.
Sovereignty.
Let's go back. It was the Washita, or serpent deity, which was worshipped in ancient Egypt as the sign of sovereignty and royalty. Now, guess where that comes from, brother? That comes from the Black Gnostic Studies of Dr. Richard King, and also is found in his Ancient Origin of Biological Psychiatry. So, that's the reason why Washita existed, and the reason why we are the only ones of the Moors in which that can actually verify land claims and have proof of it, because we demonstrate sovereignty at the highest level.
Mm-hmm.
And all this correlates to the ancient teachings as compared to a lot of the stuff in which that is not being taught, you know what I'm saying, don't make any sense. You know what I'm saying? For those in which that is speaking it, all of this, a lot of the information is not coherent, put it that way.
No.
Say it in that way. Now it says, according to Nuk-Unk-Netur by Shechem Shechem Raun Nefer Amen, the Ushetet is also another reference to the eyes of Ra and of Heru. Now, this is what he says now. Carries the meaning of strong, strength, command, protection, and are associated with the brain, commander, strong names, and statutory laws. That's what the word Ush and Ushet, which is the first portion, the root portion of Washita or Wajit, Wajita, all right? So, watch or which means brain, commander, strong name, statutory law. That's the reason why we study the law. It's right there within that also, brother.
It's all part of our nature.
Right, this is coming from Raun Nefer Amen. And also, he says, the so-called the Eye of Ra, the Ueshetta, features predominantly in the story of the battle of Heru against evil. And we already broke that down. And he goes on to say, the mystic marriage of the sun and moon in its spiritual and operative sense is the union of the soul and spirit to form the Gnostic knower, Kress, which is Christ.
Right.
The Gnostics' religion was an offshoot of the said Egyptian mysteries, which is called the Hakka or the Herbach teachings. They understood that each being must be their own Christ, or what is known as a star. So when you say that you Washita, you're saying that you are Christ.
The exalted one. Self-exalted.
That you have reached the highest level. That you have reached the higher self.
Self-anointed.
That's what this is saying. Now, they can get a portion of this information from Jerome Massey's lectures also. Mm-hmm. Written by Jerome Massey. Right now, he goes on. Raun Nefer goes on to say the left eye links up to the right hemisphere of the brain, a meaning of the Ushet association with the brain. The right side of the brain processes information visually and is responsible for the spiritual life of man, which is the mind. It governs meaning and understanding. The left side of the brain processes verbal information but cannot assemble the strings of information to enable understanding. All right, the right side draws consciously in while the left kicks it out into the physical realm. Evil in man is therefore the result of the dominance of the left brain thinking over the right brain thinking. Now, that battle is ended when one develops, check this out, when one awakens and develops the right side requires spiritual teachers and the living truth, which is associated with what? Ushetta. This is what Raun Nefer says now.
What book is that? Nuk-Unk-Netur part 1 and 2 or 3?
No, this is from another book of his. This is from what is called the Nuk-Unk-Netur. The new out, the Nuk-Unk-Netur.
Okay.
So Nuk-Unk-Netur. Nuk-Unk-Netur. All right? So. Yeah. So this is what I'm saying. So, it says here, finally we find Ushetta of Heru is the latter, check this out, is used by the latter as a chief means of resurrecting Osar. So, what is Washita used for? As the means of resurrecting Osar. This is what he said. So, this becoming Ueshetta or Washita is the means of you becoming the Christ. The awakened Osar, which is Heru. The resurrected Osar. The Esau Kares Mes. The the Moses, or Moshe, or Messiah, or Messin, which is free Messin, which is a child of the light. So all of this correlates to, all right? And so we also see that the Washitor, it says here, and this is coming from Brother Ravana, Professor Ravana Bay, from out of Chicago, third generation temple member of the Moral Science Temple of America. And it says, the Empire Washitor deduct the Maya Moors is an indigenous people of North America, the Osheta, otherwise predominantly known as the Olmecs, have been the primary group of a more general population of indigenous people identified in history as the Ameru or Amaru. Mm. Hence the origin of the word Amaraka. Hence the word Moors. Known to the Spanish and to the French, the Washitor has come to be known to English as the Adena Hopewellian people, identified with the Punic Iberian affinity, maintaining a Andalusian Carthaginian heritage, which once again goes back to Libya, Libya, the place of Gaddafi, which is actually called Punt, biblically, Punt as in Punic, but it's called Punt, P-U-N-T. All right, and it says, and such, the Washitor has been associated with the East Algonquin Native Americans, having acquired an Egyptian, an ancient Egyptian language, as well as Punic script and vocabulary, as they appear in the epigraphic records of North America.
Hmm.
Now, this is from his book, in which that is called The Washitor, Nation of Moors, A Historical Synopsis, a special report number 3, January the 8th, 2001, by the Honorable Ravana Bay, Sheikh, Minister of Education and Research, to Her Imperial Majesty, the Great Empress of the Empire, Washitor D. Doug Demanya, Berdiasi Tierra, Gaston, Washitor Tunica L. Bay, the Washitor Nation of Moors. All right?
Mm.
Third generational Moor Science Temple member.
Is that book still in print?
Yes, it is, brother. I got the book right here.
All right, all right. I'm going to talk to you about that, the price. What was the price of that book, Moore?
It's $15, brother.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to call you later on about that.
All right, appreciate you. And for those listening who also want this information, please call also before you can get it. That number is 910-364-9099. That's 910-364-9099. Also, you can read on the website, www.dralimelbey.com, D-R-A-L-I-M-E-L-B-E-Y, and check that out. All right? Now, we're getting ready to go to play a song right quick, brother. And we'll come back and go to the phone line. So y'all can call in at 626-414-3535. That's 626-414-3535. All right, check us out. All right, Brother L.
Yes,
you got anything you want to build on concerning the information that we just dropped?
Yes, sir, brother. The language, you said that we speak in the Washita, like I just spoke to you earlier, a Ha'ate Washita East, that's Medineta.
Right.
I'm very glad to know that, because at first I thought it was just in a language to ourselves. I didn't think it was a Medineta language. So in other words, it sounds like the other so-called Indians or Native Americans, whatever, Cheyenne or Apache or Comanche or Arapaho, Navajo, they speak the same language.
Right, because they're all Algonquin tribes in which that they speak Egyptian, right? More than half of their language is Metuneta, as we already have proven through the information in which that we've been teaching on here for the last hour.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
So. Mm-hmm.
Man. And that's why I was asking you earlier, did we have, do you have any books on how to speak the language? Because I definitely never put everything I got into it.
Right. Well, you're the reason why we talking about it. Exactly.
Thank you.
Yeah, definitely.
Appreciate
that.
Because, you know, we are a nationality and a culture and a you know, and a nation. And so we must have a language then,
right,
that we speak.
Right.
You know? So the matter of fact, the Metanetters is all the Ma'ata Ashby's books as well.
Right. Exactly. One of the top linguists of the Egyptian language or Kemetic or, you know, is none other than their fellow Obenga.
Uh-huh.
Their fellow Obenga is the top linguist when it comes to the Metanetter. And he has several students in which that is putting his information out also. So, I mean, you definitely want to study anything by Theophilo Obenga, Dr. Professor Theophilo Obenga, and any of his students, Muata Ashby, Raun Nefer Amen, which is Shechem or Shechem, and many others in which that is teaching the Metanetter. So, you definitely want to learn that, as well as also, in order to do a comparison, you want to learn Shri, which is the Akan language from out of Africa, in which that is 98% Metanetter.
Right.
It's more than 90%, as high as 98% Metanetter. So you want to learn Shri, you know what I'm saying? T-W-I, Shri, in which that deals with that too. We're going to go to another commercial and come right back, brother.
All right.
On the radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right. It's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. You get on into some of that order consciousness tonight. First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m. We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, let me let you know, we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday is 8 o'clock. We are now going to make this the hottest day of the week.
I've seen the numbers in top order importance. The most popular in parts of the voices for instruments. First, you say that the human conserving existence and then that's the importance of two parts of people or distance. So, to regulate the brain of our specific thing that we need to face up to the natural appearance of this. Conquer the mediate electromagnetic of sound to the entertainment of thought, strength, and smoothness. I've seen the numbers in time, order, and importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. First, you say the human conserving existence and then that's the importance of two parts of people or distance. Regulates the brain about specific things that do based on value and natural appearance of this. Current radiates electromagnetic of sound through the thing that your thoughts transmit.
All right, we back, brother.
All right.
Also, what we found out is that there are 565, actually 81 names in Canada and 484 names in the corporate United States, in which that is tied back to Egyptian, excuse me, or either Semitic, Arabic names, towns, cities, states. Like the word, for example, Mecca, India, Mecca native, Washington, Medina, Ohio, Medina, New York, Medina, Texas, Medina, North Dakota, Medina, Tennessee, Medina, Ontario, Canada, Mahomet, Illinois, Mona, Utah, Alva, Ontario, Canada, Salaam, Massachusetts, Winston-Salem, North Carolina, and there's many more examples. Matter of fact, Utah come from the word Utah, which means a group of four gods with hidden arms, which is, once again, an Egyptian name. You have Missouri, which means Musu, Mesurah. You're right there in Missouri, brother. And guess what? The name is Mesurah, which means the royal sun or the son of the sun god. I'm saying? Then you have Alabama from Alhambra, which means in the presence of Allah. You have Mississippi, which is Isis Kissippi, a Sippi, which means shrine of Isis in the ancient Kemetic language. You have Texas, which comes from where Teshesu, which means the seven divine masters of wisdom. You have Iowa, which comes from the word Ah, or Jah, which means the great. You have Minnesota, which comes from Minna or Menes, which means the first king of the first dynasty of Egypt. You have Manhattan, which comes from the word Manhattan. So Manhattan, Manhattan, which is the name of the Egyptian god of fertility, which is Men. And Aten means the prefix of an island or land or canal or district or region. So the Aten of Men is the island of the fertility god. All right. We have Tennessee. Tennessee comes from the word Tanusa, which means protectors of Tanus, which is a form of Anu, which is actually a form of Ra. Then you have Memphis, which means Menka Ptah, which is the name of ancient Egypt. You have Tallahassee, which is Ta'alahassee, which means Allah will conquer. You have Nebraska, which means Raska, Asaka, which means the word of God. You have Nevada, which comes from the word Nepata, which is the ancient Egyptian name of the Nepatans, which are the ancient or Moorish Israelite. You have Kansas, which is the word from Kanasa, which means treasure. You have Albany, as in Albany, New York, which the word Albany, which means the son of builders, the masons. That's why New York was called the New York State or the Empire State, as we would say. Philadelphia come from Philip of Philadelphius, who was one of the rulers of ancient Egypt, one of the pharaohs, which means brotherly love. So many of the aboriginal native tribal names are derived from Islamic or ancient Egyptian origin. Okay? So, like, for example, interesting that the name for chief in many Native American tribes is called Maku, as in the word Mecca. That's no coincidence.
Maku. Okay.
Or either they are called Shechem, as in the word sheik.
Come on, brother.
No. So this is what this is what we need to really be studying is linguistics.
Yeah,
you know?
Buddy.
Yeah, because it ties right back. Ties us right back into what we need to be knowing. There's no coincidence that in in Cuba Mass, there's a Mass in Cuba tribe in Central Africa, and it's reminiscent and is almost the same as the Native American Hamasa unmasked. You know, that's no coincidence. The Egyptian crook stick is the same as the Native American coup stick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which is that cross and flare, you know, as they call it, from ancient Egypt. You know, the Africans use feathers, so do the Native Americans. You know what I'm saying? I don't think that's coincidence, because the Native Americans are the descendants of the Africans or of the Moorish tribes.
Right. No way that can be coincidence.
Right. You have the Dogon village in Mali, and then you have the Native Americans in Pueblo, you know, out there in Nevada and Arizona area, in which that lives as identical on the sides of cliffs, just like the Dogon. I don't think that's coincidence. You have the Dogon Bando dance, and you have the Apache Indian dance, in which that is almost identical. You have the African thatch house of Kenya, in which that looks just like the Native American teepee.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And of course, we have the royal sphinx of the sphinx of Egypt, and then you have in Chichen Itza, the Mayan temple of South America, also, you know. So, all of this is showing the connections. You know, if you ever seen an African Zulu chief with their crown on, it looks identical to the Aztec Indian chief. Right, you got the African Mandingo dance, and you have the Aztec Indian dance. You know, so a lot of this information is connected, and you can actually go to Robert Strong Giver's website. You know, Strong Rivers website, Robert Strong Rivers. All right, So when you go there and check it out, you know, you can see a lot of this information. Now, in order to get a full understanding of the information, you need my book, First World Order. My book, with these particular topics. And for those interested, just give us a call at 910-364-9099 or go to the website, which is dralimelbay.com. And y'all slacking up. You know, we're going to the website. Y'all need to continue going to the website, because we put new information every single day. Every day there's something new. All right? We always adding stuff, always updating every day. So you're going to find things that's new. All right? Once again, the number is 626-414-3535, 626-414-3535. Give us a call. All right? We're waiting for y'all to call in. And once again, the number is 626-414-3535. Brother L, you have any closing remarks? You have any closing remarks?
Yes, sir. Brother, there's still a lot to learn out here, and a whole lot of the folks are listening. You know, I guess maybe by the show coming on so late, maybe a lot of them thought it wasn't going to come on tonight, I guess. But I like to say, you know, tune in Wednesday, same time, and Friday also, because we definitely got a lot of more science to drop on you. All right.
Appreciate that, Brother L.
And
basically, closing remarks is to start studying the Metsuneta, start studying your history, and start putting a piece of this puzzle together, because that's all it is a puzzle.
Yeah.
You got it in so many different places. That's why I go through so many books in order to try to put these pieces of the puzzle together for y'all. And hopefully, I hope y'all appreciate it. If not, then, you know, the next generation will. You know what
right.
I mean? So, nothing else. I guess we up out of here for tonight, Brother L. And we're going to go on with my man Nate. You know what I'm saying? Rise up. Oh, we'll come back and get you 818 area code. We'll come on back and get you in a second.
God damn it, an entire generation pumping gas, waiting tables.
All right, 818, you on the line. Peace.
Peace.
All right, 818, you on the line.
Hello.
Peace.
Peace, Goddess.
Peace. How are you, brothers, this evening?
Well, very well, ma'am. How you doing?
I'm good. I just want to say you all are appreciated.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah. I guess I'm gonna make it brief this time. But based on the information you've been given, it seems as though Wichita seems to be as old as creation itself.
Wichita is, we would say, based on Gerald Massey's information, is over 50,000 years old.
Okay. I guess
And there was a high priest in ancient Egypt. It was known as the Maurs, M-A-U-R, which means if you look in E.A. Wallace Budge's books, Hieroglyphics, or the Egyptian gods, you would see where he finds the word Maurs, M-A-U-R, as being the high priest of the god or the Netzer Anu.
Well, that makes a lot of sense. So a lot of things you've been teaching on here, I guess I lean more toward the esoteric side, the mystical side.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's why I said to me, it seems as though it's creation itself. And, you know, the bottom line is, I think, you know, everybody has to get in where they fit in.
True.
Everybody's not going to be attuned to certain aspects of it. And it seems like if we're coming together all together, I mean, it reminds me like the 13th tribe. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, exactly.
It's like a gathering, but everybody's just awakening at certain times, and when they figure out it seems like the problem is we don't really know who we are yet.
Mm-hmm.
And by this being the age of Aquarius, we're coming into this new age. Like you said, everyone is waking up to who they are.
Exactly.
Or waking up to their new abilities. I wasn't part of the quote-unquote conscious community. You know, it's been going on for years and years, but I still was aware of it through other teachings.
Right.
But what I found out is that everything you're saying seems to be right as that. All the teachings seem to be linked up with the Nation of Islam, all this information. And I go into certain things myself and hooked up to Noble Drew Ali.
Right.
All this stuff seems to be sitting all together. So I guess the bottom line is some people are sworn in this and some people are born
with
it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the ones that are born for it, believe it or not, even if they're not called in, the ones that are, they're studying. I study.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
I'm attracted to it.
Yeah, I
can tell. It's just something in me that's part of my mission that I got to do. Now, how I'm going to work it out, how I'm going to fit in, get in where I fit in, it'll come from the spirit.
Exactly.
And that's the only way it could come, because you got so many people who want to be in charge. I guess this whole thing is about true sovereignty within.
Exactly.
And everybody out here having different objections. So I say everybody, like I said, some people just born for this to come in and to absorb this and to take in that intelligence at a certain particular time, and they're gonna do what they're gonna do.
Right.
And they're coming, and to me, it just seems like this is just the beginning.
Right.
It's gonna work itself out. I guess that's all I had to say.
Yeah, right. Appreciate you, God. Thank you.
Appreciate you, God.
Because this is a big area, you know. This is a big area. And it seems like you're doing a lot of it yourself. Do you have people that work underneath you that, like, expand on this information and... Because this is bigger than people really imagine.
Oh yeah.
Sometimes we're so as a people we're so self-absorbed and still in that matrix that we don't even see it. That's why I said some are born for this.
Exactly.
And those that are born for it, they're listening to you whether you know it or not.
Right.
Taking notes and doing some work on the inside, because that's where it counts. That's why so many people, that's why they have not revealing that information, like you said, because they're not going into it, they're not studying self.
Right.
You really have to step to me. This is coming from me. First, they have to really have a desire to know the creator within themselves.
No doubt.
And if they don't have that, they're going to be always looking for power outside of themselves and trying to rule other people.
Right.
Well, like I said, I'm just getting off here, so I can't say that one little thing. But you think nobody was listening? I'm listening. I'm taking notes. I'm trying to get together, and I'm trying to work on myself.
Right. I got you. No doubt.
Okay, then. All right, then. You brothers having a good evening.
All right, you too, Goddess.
All right, then. Peace.
Peace. Peace and love.
All right, we got area code 347. Area code 347, you're on the line.
Hello?
Peace.
Peace.
Yeah. So definitely appreciate what y'all are doing. Unfortunately, missed most of the show tonight. Just tuned in about 5 minutes ago. But actually, my first time tuning in live. But I was just curious, you know, I was just coming into all this information as far as, these so-called black people around the world, these ancient times or whatever. And I was just curious as to, how in communication were, these people with each other? Because, I mean, I see people in China, America, Africa, all these different places. I was just curious, as far as how are they communicating with each other and were they, in contact?
Well, in order to even communicate with another people, you first have to realize that you have a nationality.
Mm-hmm.
This goes back to what Brother L said earlier. He asked a Chinese woman, does she put yellow on her race? That's her race, just because we got black on our birth certificates as a race.
Right.
Do people put crayon colors on their, on their race, so, I mean, that's the key. We have to come out of that type of thinking, We can use the word black, However, we got to use it in its proper context. It's a description. It's an adjective. It's not a proper proper name, a proper noun,
mm-hmm.
I'll be taught on Washita, because Washita is a proper noun, which that symbolizes who we are, the Nagas, The ancient race of the serpent people. Which that symbolizes the Kundalini people, the ones who raise the Kundalini energy up in order to gain immortality. And this is coming from the Return of the Surface of Wisdom of Amaru Pinkham. If you get that book, he breaks it down for you in there. If you get my book, The First World Order, I go into detail about it. So it's just about knowing who you are, and then you can communicate with other cultures.
Yeah.
The reason why we despise is because we don't have a culture. And then we don't have a language, except for someone else's language in which that was taught to us. Even though English has some Egyptian words in it. And the main nucleus of those words is centered around the family structure. The word mother comes from the word muthir or mutheru. You know what I'm saying? The word mother. Also, mm-hmm. we have the word cousin. Which that come from the word kunsu, which is the Egyptian word for Egyptian letter. We have the word father, which comes from Ptahra. So we can see and show you where these words are embedded at within the English language. That these are metu words. So you think about it. How can a handful of people come over here on a boat called Plymouth Rock? Or any other type of ship later on, and then overtake, a whole culture or traditions of people. They had to assimilate somewhat into that culture in order to even steal that culture and to enslave the people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I mean, now I'm also just curious. What do you think? I mean, because I'm assuming, this is just, a cycle we're going through or whatever right now. But, where do you see, us heading to? Because, I mean, as far as I see it, stuff just looks like it's kind of getting worse. There's different ways to look at it, but, stuff, my generation, I'm looking at is bad.
Right now, we're going through a threshold of consciousness and information. We get ready to make a quantum leap. We are now actually all making a quantum leap, into this new conscious realm through the photon belt, which that give us more information, which is known as essentially universal consciousness, universal information, is given to us now, based on the fact of the computer system being put together by the godfather of the internet, known as Philip Emeyuwali, a brother from out of Africa, from out of Nigeria, who actually put together the he's the one in which that put together HTTP, which means Hotep, which is, once again, an ancient Egyptian word in which that means peace.
That's crazy.
Right, but when you put into the engine search, you got to put HTTP, which is Hotep, you know, within the Metu-Netu, which means peace. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a lot of things in which that, you know, now is coming to the light, and we are in the age of knowing. We're going into the age of Heru, which is the age of knowing. You know, we're passing out of the cycle of Pisces, which is that the Pisces that was sacrificing mortars, and we're entering into the age of Aquarius.
You know, it's funny that you mentioned that, because just recently, it was at least like over like the past year or so, not too recently, I was having and I've heard of something called like a sleep paralysis.
Mm-hmm.
I was just having like these chronic sleep paralysis, like, I mean, it was like almost every single morning it was happening. But I mean, at first, like the first time it happened, it was, you know, kind of freaked me out a bit. But, you know, mm-hmm. I was already on, you know, meditations and stuff like that. I had early at least come to a level where I was like, nah, I mean, I knew there was nothing spooky about it. But I mean, once I really started getting into it, it opened up. It opened me up to a whole bunch of other types of stuff, like, you know, astral projection, just trying to do certain things in the sleep paralysis state as far as lucid dreaming, and it was amazing. But, I mean, actually I haven't had any lately, but it was just really interesting for me. It just kind of happened out the blue. It was almost every morning. It was just getting the sleep paralysis. But,
right.
I mean, it was definitely a good experience as well, man. It's pretty mind-blowing stuff.
Mm-hmm. And I got you. And I mean, and that's a natural part of enlightenment, is to be able to ascend from out the body, where you can realize that you're no longer trapped by the body, and that there is an afterlife, and that if the cord is cut, then you simply are the spirit in which that has exited the body, and you're not the physical body, which is nothing but a mere vessel. That's your space suit, but you're not the alien. You're just an alien inside of that space suit, the extraterrestrial astral energy inside of that spacesuit, or what is called the extraterrestrial. And as soon as you leave that spacesuit, you know what I'm saying, you journey amongst the stars. I mean, and all the ancient indigenous culture speaks about that. You know? So, right. That's what this is all about, is learning yourself.
Mm-hmm. We appreciate you, brother,
definitely coming on, chilling with us, and giving your advice, and also your experiences, sharing them with us.
Right. Yes.
Yeah. I was just going to ask, is there anything you could suggest, like, as far as, I mean, because just by myself, I've just been meditating and trying to meditate, like, daily. I've been studying up on all this information. Huh?
Right. The best thing in which I can tell you right now is to practice pranic breathing, which is you can do 7-1-7-1. You breathe in for a count of 7, hold it for a second, breathe out for a count of 7, and hold it for 1 again, and then breathe in for 7 and hold it for 1, breathe out for 7, hold it for 1. And keep doing that 100 times a day. And that will strengthen your auric field and expand it from about 15 feet outside of your normal sphere of where your aura is, which is about 3 feet outside of your body. So it expands to about 15 feet or more when you do the 100 breath techniques, which is the 7-1-7-1. So practice that and see what you experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. All right, brother. Peace.
All right, thanks.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday is 8 o'clock. We are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.